Hello and welcome to Hazard and Hope. I'm Ed, and in this episode we're looking at how you can design and adapt your floors to be more flood resilient. So here we go. This episode of Hazard and Hope is sponsored by the Scottish Flood Forum. So first things first, why would you need to make your floors more flood resilient? Well, there can be a potential weak point and route of floodwater entry into a building. When that floodwater does get inside, if the floors aren't flood recoverable, then it can make them lift, swell, distort, and require ripping out and repair. But it doesn't actually have to be this way. Adapting your floors and I suppose the property as a whole to be flood resilient can help to limit water entry. It can significantly speed up recovery times, reduce the cost of repair, and it may even mean that you don't actually have to leave your building or relocate post-flood at all or for as long. Now in this episode we're going to focus on adaptation strategies relating to the floors, but you might also find it interesting to see the episode we've made on how to make your walls more flood resilient. But let's jump back to looking at flood resilient floors. Now this kind of flood risk adaptation at the building scale is often referred to as property flood resilience, also known as PFR. And the process through which to design, construct, and operate any strategy is set out in the Code of Practice for Property Flood Resilience. And we've put the link to this guidance in the description just below, but you might also find the overview episode that we've made on the Code of Practice of interest as well. And I'll also say it's worth checking out this particular British standard as it outlines the performance expectations of various floor finishes, and we've put a link to this as well just below this video. Now, as we see in the PFR process, the first thing to consider with any strategy is its flood hazard, or the flood risk context. And the types of flooding will hugely influence the range of measures and approach to PFR that will be suitable for your given context. Because as we can see here, there's many different forces and actions on a building when it does flood, and that can include things like erosion from waves, even buoyancy and uplift as water rises up beneath the building. And as you can see here, there's many different ways in which that flood water can actually enter a property. It doesn't just have to come in through the front door, it can rise up within the void beneath a suspended timber floor and up into the building that way. And if the building's fabric and its contents are not flood recoverable, then there can be a vast amount of damage and disruption caused. Now there are primarily three types of floor build-ups used throughout the construction industry. You've got solid floors, like concrete ones, beam and block floors, and suspended floors, which can often be timber frame. And when we think about floor build-ups and finishes, it's really important to bear in mind that each material and setup will have different structural capabilities, and the material's characteristics will influence whether it needs to be stripped out, and the amount and type of drying and reinstatement that could be required. And as you can see here, there are a range of different characteristics to consider when it comes to the actual performance of different materials. And these need to work in combination. So, if we think about something like a suspended timber floor, and flood water can rise up from beneath the building and enter and damage the interior if it's not flood recoverable. Now, you can, of course, use resistance measures such as automatic air bricks to actually stop water entering that space. But it could be that flooding is from groundwater and rises up within the space. So you might actually use a sump and pump system to keep the water at that lower level in the underfloor void. Now, if the floodwater does get up and through the suspended timber floor, there are still ways that we can actually make it flood recoverable. So the floorboards themselves, for example, could be hardwood rather than softwood, and even have them braced so they don't actually swell or distort when drying. And treating the boards with multiple layers of oil-based paints, stains, and microporous paint systems can also help to limit the impact of flood water and these different elements. And even specifying expansion joints can be a good idea as there's room for the actual materials to move. Alternatively, you might actually use an avoidance-based approach and actually raise the floor level itself to get those thresholds up and out of harm's way. Or you may look to actually change the floor build-up from a suspended floor to a solid floor type. So that way you'd actually take away that underfloor void and remove a potential point or route of floodwater entry into the building. Next, let's look at beam and block floors. Now, these are widely used throughout the construction industry, but the forces from rising floodwater can cause them to lift and become unstable, and flooded voids beneath the floor can lead to damp problems if water's not removed. Now, it can make sense to use resistance measures such as automatic air bricks and a
sump and pump system to actually limit the volume of water and the rate at which it enters the underfloor voids, and even fit things like heavy-duty damp-proof membranes to limit water ingress. And in the same way as suspended floor, you could also use structural bracing to help limit the impacts of any uplift. Now, when it comes to solid floors, such as concrete floors, these can demonstrate good durability, performance and recoverability in a flood situation, but they're not necessarily going to be entirely impervious to the impacts of flooding. They can be damaged by pressure from rising groundwater. This can lead to cracks and structural faults, and you do still need to consider how things like the actual floor screed, insulation and types of floor finish can be made more flood recoverable. You can, for example, specify cement rich screeds of thicker depth for recoverability, and resin or epoxy based and waterproof screeds for structural waterproofing are increasingly available, and you may look to use a heavy duty damp proof membrane between the floor screed layers to help limit any water ingress. When it comes to the actual type of insulation used in that floor buildup, closed cell insulation types can be preferable in these contexts, but you do need to select an appropriate grade and bear in mind the potential risks of buoyancy and uplift, especially in areas where you have groundwater flood risk. I mean, the types of insulation that are often used in basement tanking can work well in these contexts, as they're actually designed to be more water compatible. But the performance will be affected if it's used in environments that are wet frequently or for prolonged periods of time. Now, coverings like carpets can be what we often see filling up the skips outside flood-damaged homes, and you know, it really only takes a shallow depth of floodwater to cause widespread damage and contamination of something like a carpet. The actual manner in which they've been fitted often makes it quite challenging for them to be quickly removed out of harm's way, and if left for long periods of time in a damp state, they can trap moisture and limit ventilation and actually affect the floor surface below. Now, you could of course design the carpet to be actually easily rolled up pre-flood and plan ahead so that any furniture is really easy to lift and move off it. But you know, that can take time, and I mean, it's actually often the bottom two or three steps of a staircase that can get damaged by flood water. So yeah, you might actually specify a material on those treads that's more flood recoverable. Alternatively, it might actually be that the carpet's cheap and easy to replace, and you kind of deem it as sacrificial. But I'd say, you know, we really don't want to be creating more waste. You could instead actually specify a tile, stone or composite flooring with waterproof grouts on joints and actually have a rug on it that can just be easily rolled up pre-flood. But it's important to be aware that flood water can cause tiled floors to lift, and the joints between the tiles will often trap contaminants. But if things like ceramic, quarry tiles or stone floors are specified and installed correctly with waterproof grouts and adhesives, then these can actually be really easily cleaned and reinstated in quite a short space of time after a flood. And tiles can also be covered in resin to actually provide an additional sealant, and it may even be that you actually have them as skirting boards and upstands to ensure more of an effective joint between the floors and walls. And we saw Sue actually has this kind of floor in her home, and having that drain at the lowest point of a room is an obvious thing to say, but you know, it can actually make a lot of sense to have a very slight fall and slope on the floor itself, like you'd find in something like a wet room. Last of all, let's look at laminate floors. Now, flood water can cause boards to lift, and when water is absorbed, swelling and bowing can occur. Now, in terms of options, you've really got the full range of different ones that we've discussed here. So, you know, you could use resistance measures to try and stop the flood water from reaching that space, even design in something like expansion gaps to provide space for any boards that may move and swell. Or it might actually be that you look to replace the flooring with more flood recoverable materials, such as sealed tiled floors, stone or solid wood flooring. Now, that's an overview of just some of the approaches for making your floors more flood resilient, but remember that the suitability and selection depends of course on the actual particular flood risk context, the property setup, its function, and of course the actual property owner's preferences. But I would say, you know, it's not uncommon to actually find three or even four different types of flooring in a property. It could actually even be that the floor buildup or type varies throughout it because of different extensions and alterations that have been made over time, and each of these may actually require a different approach. For example, if we look at Claire's house, she's actually got a combination of suspended timber and solid floors, and her home is part of a row of terraced houses where floodwater can flow and move in the void beneath the buildings. But what they've done is actually have flood barriers and automatic air bricks in place to try and limit water entry into that space, as well as sumps and pumps within the floor void to get any flood water out that does come into that space. But if the flood water does come inside the property, the interior is also flood recoverable so that it can be really easily cleaned up post-flood. One of Claire's neighbours has even gone a step further and actually switched from having a suspended timber floor to a solid concrete floor. Again, that really helps to remove any of the risk from that potential point of floodwater entry. Now, a couple of disclaimers about this approach. Making your floors more flood resilient or flood recoverable does not mean that they will be completely unaffected by floodwater or will be entirely back to their former condition post-flood. Excessive depths or durations of floodwater can cause materials to fail or thresholds to be exceeded. The building's fabric and its contents can still require cleaning, decontamination, and redecoration. And we've put a range of links to guidance on the actual drying of buildings in the description just below this video. But really, any successful PFR setup will need to be operated and maintained in the right way. And the actual hierarchy and interconnectedness of measures does really need to be clearly documented in a handover pack and a flood recovery plan made to actually set out the actions that people would take before, during, and after a flood event. Now, a lot of the discussions have been so far around the idea of retrofitting or upgrading the floors of an existing building to be more flood resilient. But these approaches can, of course, also be specified and applied to new build contexts. So if you think you'd like to look into making the floors of your property more flood resilient, then what's the next step? Well, the code of practice shows the process that we need to go through. And ultimately, the first step is to get advice from a suitable professional on your flood hazard and your property setup, so they can help you actually review which options may be suitable for your given context and user preferences. So thanks very much for listening. And if you'd like to keep updated on future episodes, then please subscribe below, hit the bell for notifications, and we look forward to seeing you soon.